Delighted you made it out to Trinity, especially on a night like this with the heavy rains and so forth. Someone once told me that the state animal of Illinois was the construction horse, so that probably didn't help either. You guys are to be commended for being here and welcome. I also want to welcome the people who are visiting us online. This is streaming live over the internet. I'll do my best to include you guys in on this debate discussion that we're having tonight using my trusty iPad and Twitter and so forth. If you want to bring a question in via the internet, you would tweet at Carl Henry Center, and I will be able to see that immediately right here up in the front. Tonight's Trinity Debates installment is sponsored by the Kern Foundation, Sojourners, the Institute of Faith, Work, and Economics, and the Henry Center. I am Dr. Chris Firestone, professor and chair of the philosophy department at the Trinity College. I've served as the regular moderator of these debates for the last 11 years or so since their inception here. The Trinity debates were born out of a partnership originally between the philosophy department and the honors program, and has since migrated over to the Henry Center for theological understanding. And as you can see, the Henry Center does a wonderful job at sponsoring these debates. Thank you, Jeffrey Fulkerson and Tom McCall, for helping to organize this event. In the earlier debates, we zeroed in on philosophical topics of abiding interest to the Christian community. In the fall of 2002, we first debated whether or not Christians should be substance dualists or materialists. Subsequent debates focused on things like Christianity and the philosophy of Immanuel Kant and the problem of God's hiddenness. With the support of the Henry Center, we have in recent years facilitated debates of increasing relevance to the church, including the implications of religious pluralism for Christianity and the doctrine of the Trinity. Last year, some of you may recall, we had Jim Wallis and Dr. R. Albert Moeller here, where we debated the issue of whether or not social justice was an essential part of the mission of the church. So stimulating was that debate that we decided to have Jim Wallis back. The question of tonight's debate comes in two parts. What is the common good, and how should the church and Christians pursue it? The best way for me to introduce this topic, I think, is to give you a sense of how we landed on it. The Trinity debate format typically chooses a topic of interest to the academy and the church. We then put it into a yes-no question, and one debate participant chooses to defend the yes side, and another chooses the no side. With this debate, we started with the topic of the church and the pursuit of the common good. This general question or topic morphed into a question: is there a role for the church in seeking the common good? And if so, what is it? Both of our debate participants answered the first question with a resounding yes. Of course the church should be seeking the common good. The what question is where the two participants showed substantial disagreements. What is the role of the church in pursuit of the common good? The problem, of course, is with the what aspect of that question. It does not lend itself to a yes-no format. We tried through a series of emails to develop a yes-no question surrounding this topic that would clarify the disagreements between them. This proved to be like trying to steal an acorn from that little squirrel on the Ice Age, in the feature film Ice Age. It just wasn't going to happen. In the end, we decided that it was best to ask both participants to present their positions on how the church should go about pursuing the common good. And perhaps this is how it should be. I think having dinner with both these gentlemen tonight, I think what we saw is that they both have a heart for it. They believe that the common good is important and that the church should be about pursuing it in some measure. And so we're going to hear more on that tonight. If you're like me, with more than just a little philosophical inquisitiveness, you might ask, what do we mean by the common good? While we were negotiating this topic via email, I presented what one might call a minimal requirement for understanding what is meant by the common good to both participants. Both agreed it would be a fine starting point for the discussion, but certainly not the end of the discussion. And here's the quote from that small definition that I gave. By the common good, we mean not the eternal state of human beings, but the temporal welfare of the community, including its local, national, and international forms. It thus refers to specific goods in this world that are shared by or beneficial to all or most members of a given community. Both participants, it seems, agree that the church should be about promoting the temporal welfare of the community and society more broadly construed. However, many in this environment will be interested in knowing more about the participants' more sacred understanding of the common good. In other words, as a Christian, I recognize that the human predicament is not all about flesh and blood, but also about angels and principalities. As a recent article in Christianity Today put it, to believe we humans can achieve good on our own, even working together without the radical intervention of God, is ultimately to deny the doctrines of creation, cross, resurrection, and second coming, just for starters. In this light, what I hope will come of tonight's discussion is a better sense of what these Christian leaders think the common good is and how they would like the church to go about pursuing it. So allow me, with those brief remarks, to introduce our participants tonight. Jim Wallis is a best-selling author, public theologian, and frequent speaker on faith and public life. He's the author of God's Politics, Rediscovering Values. His latest book is titled God's Side, What Religion Forgets and Politics Hasn't Learned About Serving the Common Good. Just as a brief aside, after we're done, he will be able to sign your copy of that out in the foyer. He is president and CEO of Sojourners and editor-in-chief of Sojourners Magazine, whose combined print and electronic media have a readership of more than 250,000 people. His columns appear in major newspapers and blogs, and he regularly appears as a television and radio commentator. He is a husband, father of two young boys, and a Little League baseball coach. And he likes to talk about him. I saw that at dinner. That was great. Please join me in giving a warm Trinity welcome to Jim Wallis. I'm going to go ahead and introduce Jay Richards first. Yeah. Dr. Jay Richards is a senior fellow at the Discovery Institute in Seattle and a visiting scholar at the Institute of Faith, Work, and Economics. Dr. Richards has a PhD with honors in philosophy and theology from Princeton Theological Seminary. He is author of many books, including Money, Greed, and God, winner of a 2010 Templeton Enterprise Award, and co-author of the New York Times best-selling book, Indivisible. Dr. Richards' articles and essays have been published in the Harvard Business Review, the Washington Post, the Wall Street Journal, the Washington Times, and a variety of other publications. Please join me in giving a warm Trinity welcome to Dr. Jay Richards. Okay, as far as the format of the debate slash discussion that we're going to have tonight, the Trinity debates typically run on a back and forth format, but we will start that way and we'll loosen up to a more informal discussion type format as we go along. The participants, to start, will each have 20 minutes for their respective opening statements. This will be followed by a 10-minute maximum response period from each one. And then we will have a short interchange, informal interchange, between them about 10 minutes more. And then we will open it up for questions and answers, Q&A, after that. In an effort to keep those questions concise and on topic, we're asking that you write them down, if you will, on the pieces of paper that we've provided to you, or if you're online, you can go ahead and tweet them to me. And then we will collect those after the opening statements are done, and we'll get a chance to ask those for you in the Q&A period. Each participant will be notified of the time remaining for their presentation. Is there right here? And we'll ask them to finish up their thought as we get down to zero with their time remaining. The whole event should conclude no later than 9:10. Without further ado, I would like to turn it over to Jim Wallis for our first 20 minutes.
I'm impressed that you all made it through this weather tonight, and I'm glad Trinity couldn't find somebody who was against the common good. That's a good start. So Jay and Chris, I'm glad to be here tonight. I didn't really come for a debate, though I'm happy to stick to the framework of the debate, because I think we as a nation are losing the debate about the common good. The nation is losing the debate about the common good. So how can Christians, how can we as Christians change that conversation? So this book tour really is our my hope of sparking, helping in some small way to spark a national conversation on the common good. So tonight I hope we can get into that and talk together about all of that. I'm glad to be back at my alma mater, at Trinity. I was here a few years ago. Glad to be back again. And I enjoyed our last conversation. It was really more a very civil discussion than a debate. In fact, I think we showed the world how you can agree and disagree, but in a Christian kind of way. So that's also new in these days. We got talking at dinner about our kids and sports and coaching, and so I'm going to start there. Preachers often end with a story about hope. I'm going to start with one, because the more I'm on the road the last 3 weeks on this book, I'm discovering how hopeless people feel about change, about progress, about anything happening for the good. A lot of hopeless feelings out there. So let me tell a story about baseball. I coach Jack's team, my youngest son, he's 10. And last year we started with this team. They were 9 years old, 9 and 10 year old league, and we were the youngest team, so we lost our first 4 games, which wasn't surprising, but not encouraging to them. And it's the fifth game, fifth inning, we're down 5-0. And I'm trying to get the kids to be encouraged, and the top of the lineup goes down and out, and the bottom lineup comes up, and through no fault of their own, 2 kids get on base. They walked, and the other were on base. And up steps the worst kid on the team, Stefan. Not because he's a great kid, he just had never played baseball. His parents were international, D.C., lots of international parents. So he had no clue about baseball, not a clue. But somehow the ball hits the bat, and it's in center field. And 2 kids score, and Stefan is on second base. Now, he's a Brit, so he's very polite. He starts walking over to shake hands with a shortstop from second base. I say, Stefan, you got to stay on the base. He says, oh, I've never been here before. And that began a rally, and we won 11-5. I gave Stefan the game ball. And afterwards, I always have team discussions about what we learned today from our game. And here's what I heard. I heard them say, one kid said, sometimes what you need comes from unexpected places. Another one said, we all were necessary to the win today. All of us were needed. My star player then said, it shows you can never, ever give up on hope. So I was doing the Virginia Theological Commencement Address that next weekend. So I told this story, and the title of my address was The Vocation of the Church to Provide Unexpected Hope. And I want to start there tonight. I took a sabbatical to write this book, and that meant 3 months away from the political news cycle. I was under a discipline not to speak or write or be interviewed about politics during an election year, which was tough for me. It was a difficult discipline. First 3 months of the election year. And every morning I'd get up early, have some quiet, and then I'd exercise, and all day I'd read and write, but at night I'd watch the news cycle, the news. And the more I was disengaged, but the more I watched it, the more depressing it all really seemed. The vitriol, the polarization, paralyzation, the anger, the fear, and the hatred on all sides, how shallow our media and our politics were. And I realized how much we had lost this ancient idea called the common good. And it goes back centuries. Let me just read one of the quotes that someone sent to me. "This is the rule of the most perfect Christianity, its most exact definition, its highest point, namely the seeking of the common good. For nothing can so make a person an imitator of Christ as caring for his neighbors." Said by John Chrysostom, 347 to 407. Goes back a long way. And of course, for me as a Christian, the spiritual foundation for this is really the second commandment. It was always lawyers asking Jesus questions in the Gospels. I think they're all Washington lawyers. And what's this about? And he said, to love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Love your neighbor as yourself. Of course, that's in Judaism, it's in Islam. But for me as a Christian, it's right at the heart of what Jesus said. And as I was reflecting on that during my sabbatical, what really struck me most was how, and as parents, some of you will understand when I say this, I never thought I could love anything or anyone as much as I love my 14-year-old Luke and my 10-year-old son, Jack. And that's okay, I think. But Jesus is saying, I gotta love other people's kids as much as I love my own. That's a transformational ethic, and it was supposed to be from the start. And I talk in the book about how who we think Jesus is, and this was our topic last time, who we think Jesus is and why we think he came will determine the kind of Christians we really are going to be. Now, I can talk more about that, but there's a whole, this is the most biblical, theological book I've written for some time. And there are many chapters there about that question, who is Jesus, why he came, and what this says about the common good. But let me focus more on the second half where I'm trying to apply the common good. Now, let me just, this question of what is the common good. I do like Catholic social teaching on this. I also like the evangelical revivals. You know, Wesley and Finney have these wonderful notions of the common good. The Black Church has lived this way for years. Black churches hold whole neighborhoods together, whole cities together, serving the common good. But here's what Catholic social teaching says. Common good is the whole network of social conditions which enable human individuals and groups to flourish, human flourishing, and to live a fully, genuinely human life, otherwise described as integral human development. All are responsible for all. Let me say that again. All are responsible for all, collectively, at the level of society or nation, not only as individuals. So I try to apply that to several things. I'll just briefly touch on them. There's whole chapters on these in the book, but I'll briefly touch on them. One, democracy, redeeming democracy. Well, watching the election showed me more than ever how the checks have replaced all the balances in our public life. When U.S. senators tell me they've got to raise $20,000 every day to get reelected, which affects who they call, who they have lunch with, who they spend time with, we have a problem. There's a whole issue of money and politics that has to be addressed, and I think it is fundamentally a moral issue. The issue of economic trust, we've lost trust in how economics functions, who makes the decisions and how they're made. In fact, we've talked a lot at Davos, the World Economic Forum, where I now go every year and have this discussion with business leaders, how we've lost all our social contracts, and what they're feeling a need for is a new social covenant. And covenant is their word from the business CEOs, a moral dimension to economics. We have to move from short-termism or the metric of quarterly profit and loss statements for shareholders to a longer-term metric that takes, indeed, stakeholders into effect, consumers, workers, the environment itself, and indigenous people say you make decisions today based on their impact on the seventh generation out. That's a very different metric than quarterly profit and loss statements for shareholders. These conversations are alive and well, not just on Occupy Wall Street, they were there too, but also at places like Davos. Government, I think the question in Washington, D.C. is the wrong question. Big government or small government? That's the wrong question. The question is, what's the role of government? What's the function? What's the vocation of government? So a chapter here called A Servant Government takes, starting with Romans 13. What is the role of government? And there are clear procedural notions about fairness in the judicial system, the rule of law operating, and there are notes really about how government, as government, is supposed to look after, be concerned about the poor and the vulnerable. The prophets all say that. The gleaning from the fields, part of, that's not a charitable contribution, that's part of your field is to be reserved for those who are on the edges. There's a whole lot of biblical work here on the role of government, which I don't think is liberal or conservative, but trying to say, what does a servant government mean? Then there's a whole chapter on, I call it making things right. The biblical language for justice really is about making things right. There's a growing, we were talking at dinner, how there's a growing sense among many younger evangelicals, a real passion now for justice. And that wasn't the case when I began seminary many years ago. I think it is now, but many of them are going into ministry and they're doing mission trips and they're working on trafficking. And for example, let's take trafficking. You can be rescuing women and children from brothels all over the country, not just Cambodia, but Deerfield, trust me, Bannockburn, they're everywhere. And you'll have a lot to do because the number of slaves are growing. There are more now than when Wilberforce freed the slaves 200 years ago. But if you deal with what's at the heart of it, you gotta deal with money laundering, politicians who are involved in it, protecting it. What kind of regulations and laws would actually break the hold of trafficking? How do you get something right? I was at World Vision just on Wednesday, and World Vision says, as we all say, you don't just teach somebody, you don't just give somebody a fish, you teach them how to fish. I'm all for that, okay? There's another question, who owns the pond? Who controls the waterways? Who shapes the well-being of the fish, the ecosystem, and water is gonna be the most conflictual resource now in the world, more than oil in the days ahead. So those questions of control and power and structure and justice are extremely important biblical questions. I was last Sunday night in Birmingham, Alabama. I got to speak with Brother John Lewis, Congressman from Georgia. John Lewis is really the conscience of the U.S. Congress in many ways. And we were there because it was the 50th anniversary of Dr. King's letter from a Birmingham jail 50 years ago. And there was never any response to that letter until last Sunday night, a week ago Sunday, when many church leaders, evangelical, mainstream, Protestant, Catholic, all Orthodox, all came together and they wrote a response to King's letter. And he's being criticized by other clergy for making trouble in Birmingham. Of course, you know, brutal discrimination. Bull Connor had sick dogs and fire hoses on children. And King was in jail and he was blamed by the clergy for stirring up trouble, you know, talking about the civil rights issue. And you should read that letter. It's a powerful, powerful classic statement of a clergyman's response to those who were challenging him about why he was doing this. And what's powerful even more deeply is his vision of a beloved community, he called it. And he intended this to be, he thought, the mission of the church, create this beloved community. And out of that would flow, would radiate, he said, these streams of justice. And from that, we would see the common good get better, like a civil rights law in 1964, voting rights in 65. These were incremental changes that made the common good better, but underneath this was a powerful vision of a beloved community. I have a whole chapter in the book on this vision of the beloved community. But John Lewis talked about how you have to sometimes get in the way of things that are wrong to make things right. And John Lewis, as a young man, now he's almost 80, but he's as fiery as ever, but he was almost beaten to death on the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma, Alabama, on Bloody Sunday, it was called. And the clergy came down. I was with Martin Marty today at the University of Chicago, and he was one of those who went down to Selma to march with King Abraham Joshua Heschel from Boston, the rabbi. And in 5 months, we had a Voting Rights Act, changing, making something right that was wrong. I talk a lot in the book about, though, healthy households, and this is where I'm realizing as a dad and as a little league coach, the choices we make in our households with those who are closest to us, our kids, our family life, those choices, those decisions, those values that we teach may do more to serve the common good than almost anything we do outside of our households. Now, you might say, that's funny coming from Jim Wallis, who talks about how to change things in Washington. Well, yes, but family dinners are really important for the common good, for example. And finally, the last chapter is on the parish. I love this notion of the parish. My wife is a Church of England priest, and John Wesley said, the world is my parish. How do we take responsibility? St. Catherine's Parish thought they were responsible for these 15 square blocks that they lived in, 24/7. Whether or not the people were believers or not, they were responsible for all of them in those 15 square blocks. And I think we are responsible, as Wesley said. Let me give an example of how we're doing that. Washington, D.C., nothing is going well right now, except one thing. By the August recess, you will see comprehensive immigration reform. I'm predicting it. You'll see it. And if you talk to the White House and the Republicans and Democrats as to why, they will point to the work of the faith community and to evangelicals in particular who are changing the conversation about immigration reform. I was in Baylor yesterday to speak in chapel, and we had a big conference at Baylor and on immigration because it's called G92. The word for stranger is in the Bible 92 times. And evangelicals are being converted by their Bibles. When Jesus says, I was a stranger, and you welcome me, how we treat the stranger is how we treat Jesus, evangelicals are realizing. So at the border of these two signs, no trespass and help wanted. In between those signs, 11 million undocumented people are trapped and stuck and vulnerable. And now we're trying to fix a broken system, not just taking care of the victims. Taking care of the victims is a good thing. Taking care, acting about the symptoms is a good thing. Sometimes you have to fix something that is wrong, a system, a structure, and that's what evangelicals are now doing in Washington, D.C. So we roam, Sojourners is involved, so are the Southern Baptists, Al Mohler's church, they're involved. I got a call the weekend before a big press conference from Focus on the Family. Jim Daly called, can I join you? They joined us. When people see all of us, Anglo, Hispanic, all together, it sends a signal. So I'm trying to figure out as I close here for this section, are there a series of issues, a series of big questions, like immigration reform, like some others I'll mention later on, where Christians, who maybe are coming from different political places, could show some common ground for the common good? Mike Gerson is a speechwriter, was for George Bush, and he has a comment on the back of the book I'd like to read. Mike's a friend of mine. We've become very close. Jim Wallis and I have a variety of differences on domestic and international policy, but there is no message more timely or urgent than his call to actively consider the common good. The title of the book is On God's Side, What Religion Forgets and Politics Hasn't Learned About Serving the Common Good. Lincoln, the quote in the front of the book is my favorite Lincoln quote about religion. He says, my concern is not whether God is on our side, My greatest concern is to be on God's side. Now, Lincoln didn't always know what it meant to be on God's side, but he knew that was the right question. I can't tell you the 10 things that make for the common good tonight, but that's the right question. Asking what it means to be on God's side, asking how together as Christians we can serve the common good is really what I hope this night is about. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jim. Well, now we'll have our 20-minute opening statement from Jay Richards.
Great, thank you. Thanks so much to the Henry Center and to TEDS for having this event. I've been looking forward to it for months, and I was excited. I was able to get a copy, actually, of Jim's book sort of in preprint form, and it's an honor to be sharing the stage with them tonight. That's the wrong slideshow. I want to do my slideshow. I'm going to use a PowerPoint. And Jim talked a little bit about how we articulate the common good in the public square and how we do that as Christians. And I think that's really important, and that's a huge topic. And I'm not going to talk really anything about that tonight, but what I want to do is I want to just sort of focus on this basic question. First of all, you know, who's commons, which good, which is the title of the event tonight, and then the church, the Christians, and the common good. And of course, we've got kind of two issues here. And one is, what is the common good? How should we think about it, and then how should we implement it? And so I think before, you know, sort of preliminary to figuring out what we ought to do or how we ought to do it, we want to get clear in our own thinking what exactly the common good is. And what we should do is, as the church institutionally, sort of, in, you know, the church universal, and individual Christian communities and individual Christians, how we sort of affect that. And I appreciate that Chris, he described the sort of inception of the event, because it did start out, okay, we're going to have a debate about the common good, and we'll have one that's for it and one that's against it, you know, and we realize that, yeah, that doesn't, I don't know, maybe there's someone somewhere that says that a Christian shouldn't pursue the common good, but that seemed like, gosh, I don't know, I think I told you, Chris, that, so that's going to be the sound of one hand clapping, because we'll just, Jim and I'll get up and say, yes, absolutely, and sit down. But I do think that when we're sort of thinking about widespread sort of social or cultural action, that there's a kind of important way of thinking about these things that I think can be helpful, and that I hope can sort of break down barriers with Christians. Won't necessarily all agree, but at least we'll understand what we're disagreeing about or what we're agreeing about. Well, as Jim said, there's a number of definitions of common good, and in fact, it's as old as the church. John Chrysostom, certainly the church fathers, but it's been developed by Protestants and Catholics. But let me just give you one kind of working definition here from Gaudium et Spes, which is a sort of Vatican II document that of bishops in the 1960s. I like this summary because it's not kind of specifically Catholic or Protestant, but it tries to encapsulate all of the important theological reflection on this idea of the common good, and to defend it in, you know, frame it in a defensible way. That's always the dilemma. We can sort of talk about things in the abstract, but you know, what exactly do we mean? Here's how Gaudium et Spes puts it. It says, the common good is the sum of those conditions of social life whereby men, families, and associations more adequately and readily may attain their own perfection. And I like that. If you just sort of one-stop shopping, a single-sentence description of the common good, that's what we want, and we recognize that different conditions in social life can affect associations, that is, you know, private groups, charitable organizations, businesses, those are associations, families, and individuals. Think of the Korean Peninsula, right? Think of what it's like being a Christian in North Korea versus South Korea, and how much easier it is to, say, to present the gospel, to articulate things as a Christian in the public square in South Korea versus North Korea. The social conditions in South Korea, it's not utopia, but they're much more conducive to the natural ends and the created ends. We're beings made in God's image. We have natural created ends that we're supposed to achieve, and some societies and social settings are better for achieving those things than not. I also like this definition because it makes it clear it's different from what's often called the political good. You know, the political process, or we could say the federal government, it has natural ends and purposes and goods that it can fulfill, but the common good is really broader than that. And to kind of get at it, what we want to do is think of society or think of our sort of social setting as broader and prior to any sort of political experiment. Right, so there were people and communities in American colonies prior to there being a constitution or a Declaration of Independence. Those precede the state. And so when they're talking about the common good, we're not talking merely about the political good or what the sort of state's supposed to do. We're talking about the commons, more broadly speaking. And also, it's not something like you might call it the communal or the collective good. And, you know, the worst manifestations of this would be something like Stalinist Russia, obviously, in which the goods of individuals and families are subordinated to the presumed good of the collective. And so the individual, as a creature made in the image of God with inherent rights and dignity, that's sort of erased and wiped out in defense of some supposed collective good, which is separate from that. No, in fact, if we think about the common good carefully, we're going to understand the common good is those social conditions that sort of have to do with those things that we hold in common as human beings. And so they're going to include and incorporate the fact that we're individuals. All of us are individuals with certain rights and dignity. In the normal sort of social setting in which children are raised is a family. It's a fundamental social institution. And then we are inherently social, of course. If you're born as an infant, you must be raised by your parents. We're inherently social because we're created by God. And so it's not a matter of being we're just individuals or we're just social. It's a matter of understanding the social conditions and the common good in a way that takes account both of what we are as individuals and as associations and families. Now, it doesn't mean necessarily that everybody has to do everything. Obviously, we don't all have exactly the same responsibilities. I'm more responsible for what my daughters do than, say, a random person pulled out of the Philadelphia phone book or something like that. A pastor in his or her work isn't necessarily doing the same thing as a development missionary or an entrepreneur or a church counselor or any of these sorts of things. And so there's always going to be particularity both with respect to our calling and with respect to our particular situation. We're beings with limited time and resources and energy and a limited knowledge. And so that's going to sort of constrain these things. I think it's important to realize, for instance, you could say something like this, that the church as church, perhaps its primary way of pursuing the common good, is something like making disciples of all nations. I think this might have been what the early evangelicals that Carl Henry criticized, maybe this is what they were after, that the purpose of the church as the church is to go and make disciples of all nations, and if the church doesn't do that, there's nobody else to do that, and so that's what we ought to focus on. The problem is they tended to get tied into an artificial attachment just to sort of evangelism. So the idea is that, well, you know, the world's going to hell in a handbasket. Why polish the brass on a sinking ship? The best we can do is let's just try to save as many souls as we can before the whole thing blows up. Right? Well, that was the attitude that Carl Henry was critiquing. And I think he had right reasons to do that. And in fact, I agree wholly with his sympathy. Certainly, the church's primary role in pursuing the common good may be to make disciples of all nations. But notice, even in that capacity, we're not just talking about the internal destination of individuals. We're talking about all of God's created reality. You know, to call to mind the Dutch theologian and statesman Abraham Kuyper, his famous quote that there's not one square inch of human existence over which Christ does not declare mine. So the political realm is a part of God's created reality. The realm that the scientists study, astronomers and physicists, that's part of God's created reality. Who we are as individuals, all those things are part of God's created reality. And when the church pursues that primary mission of making disciples of all nations, even that has what you might call sort of spin-off effects for temporal life. Now, in Catholic social teaching, incidentally, eternal destiny is normally included in the common good. But we're not talking about that tonight. We're talking about the sort of temporal goods that we have. So, you know, education and enjoyment of families and the ability to raise children freely and not to be molested by people that are more powerful than us. All those things have to do with this. And so the question is, though, do Christians and do the church have secondary duties? Even if making disciples has positive spin-offs, maybe it affects economics positively. Societies that are deeply religious, at least in certain types of religion, tend to do better economically. And even neighborhoods in the West, there have been some studies that have shown that where there are large groups of Christians clustered, even their neighbors that won't be Christians often find themselves in better circumstances. And so it's quite possible, and I'm convinced, that the moral and cultural and spiritual reality of disciple-making has all of these amazing spin-off effects, and we should expect that. We're not angels in bodies, and we're not sort of apes swinging from the trees. We're material and spiritual hybrids, and so we have both temporal and eternal ends. So that's a kind of preliminary, but you know, the question is, okay, how can we think about this, though, as Christians, when we're talking about politics, when we're talking about what, you know, what the Congress ought to do about immigration, to speak to a very timely topic? What should we do in terms of economic policy? How do we pursue that? And so that's what I want to spend the last few minutes talking about. And my background is philosophy, and so I tend to try to reduce everything to its essence and simplify it insofar as that's possible. And so I think a way of thinking about the what I would call the political question is to think of this question, or to ask this question: when is coercion warranted? Now, coercion comes in lots of different forms, obviously. You know, the coercion I experience if I don't pay my taxes or return my tax return, that's different from how someone that's, you know, in the middle of a shootout in a city square is going to experience the coercive effects of the state. But I do think there's kind of an internal logic. Paul says it in Romans 13 that, you know, the state bears the sword. It has an exercise of justice, of punishing the evildoer, of separating out the good from the evil in social context. And to do that, sometimes coercion must be used. Now, there are some Christians that say, well, no, coercion should never be used. And somebody that's really a strict pacifist or certainly an anarchist would say it's never morally justified to coerce. Most Christians, though, across the spectrum think, okay, there's some things for which coercion is appropriate. So things like murder, right, or rape, or torturing small children for the fun of it, right? We all think, you know, in situations like that, it's good that we have someone that bears the sword officially. And so that's usually, at least at the core, we've got something like legitimate defense capacities, so the work that the American military does, not in general, but that particular function, and the police function of maintaining public order and the rule of law in public. Now, and I would argue that those are the sort of key things the government ought to do, it has a mandate to do, and that it's best at, and that it does it in a way that no other institution or individual can. But I think sometimes we're too cavalier in sort of assigning things to the political sphere or to the responsibility of the state without asking this question. Is it really appropriate that that be something for which people should be coerced over? It may be low-level stuff. It might be not being able to get your 64-ounce Big Gulp, right, in Manhattan. It's not a big deal. But, you know, at some point, if society has thousands and thousands of these things, and all of them have been given, or the jurisdiction of the state or federal government, you get something like de Tocqueville's soft tyranny that sort of builds up. And so I think we need to sort of think clearly about, look, if there's a way to do something voluntarily or freely, and, you know, whatever that is, that should be preferred to having it done coercively. And so if we hand something over to the state, we should feel satisfied that, in fact, that's kind of the only way to get that good done. So that's what I call the political question. And then let's call this the economic question. The economic question has to do with finding out about that realm of God's created reality that we can just call the economic realm, right? And so somebody that does chemistry, you can learn a lot about the properties of elements and compounds and certain types of reactions, and the experiments can be replicated on the other side of the world. Because God's created that, part of his reality has this internal logic and order that can actually be uncovered by human beings. Well, that's chemistry. It's the same thing in physics or in history. These are all part of God's created reality over which Christ declares mine. The economy's the same way, but we tend not to think that way, that the economic realm has its own internal principles, its own internal kind of causal rules and logic that can be to some degree discovered. And so the economic question is to figure out what are the key insights and discoveries, empirical discoveries, in the economic realm. Now notice I'm distinguishing this from economic ideologies or political ideologies. Those are different things. In the same way as I think we would distinguish between, say, orthodox neo-Darwinism as a scientific theory, but also an ideology, and the evidence of biology, that those are two different things, and biologists agree on a lot of the same basic things, whatever their views of the Darwinian question are. In the same way, we should think of economics in this way. There's a lot of sort of fighting and jousting, a lot of partisanship that unfortunately doesn't get at that. But the reality is even amidst the disagreements, there are things we've learned about the economic realm that we know now, that we understand now, that were not known even a few centuries ago. We understand what the price function is and how it relates to supply and demand. We understand how people estimate economic value. We understand what happens if you fix prices and all these kinds of things. We need to take those into account. So the economic question is just, what are those things? And I would think our goal, if we're wanting to pursue the common good in the economic sphere, is to do this. We want to integrate the descriptive truths and theoretical insights of economics with the normative principles of ethics and the relevant truths of theology. This would be our goal as Christians if we're wanting to pursue the common good in our various capacities in the economic sphere. So notice I'm talking about an integration of two different things. You don't learn all that much about the price function from the text of Scripture, but you don't learn that people are creative agents made in the image of God by studying economics. And so what we want is an integration of these two different things. Now, when I've been telling college students something like this for a while, they tend to sort of panic because they think, okay, well, I can understand, I mean, as Christians, we need to know the Bible, we need to know theology, but now you're telling me that in order to make kind of decisions about economic policy, I gotta study economics? Don't panic, because that's not quite what I'm saying. I'm talking about what the late Henry Hazlitt called the art of economics, and this is just a particular intellectual training that we submit ourselves to. And that if we do it, I think we can actually glean most of the insights of economics if we make it a real intellectual habit. Here's what Hazlitt said. He said, the art of economics consists in looking not merely at the immediate, but at the longer effects of any act or policy. It consists in tracing the consequences of that policy, not merely for one group, but for all groups. In other words, for any particular economic proposal, if you've mastered the art of economics, the first question should be, oh, and then what will happen, right? So someone proposes, let's have attach our trading relationships to stringent child labor laws in Asia. And you say, oh, that sounds nice. We don't want, you would hate to have young children working in sweatshops. But then what will happen if we do that? Let's raise the federal minimum wage to $50 an hour or whatever. Well, and then what will happen? That's the art of economics. Now, we can't be responsible for the sort of outcomes of policies that are unanticipatable. Right, it's like the butterfly effect, the butterfly flapping his wings in Shanghai, it could create a thunderstorm in Seattle. I don't know that that's true, but the idea is that there are events and they have effects that we can't account for. But when it comes to economic policies, in fact, there's a whole lot of stuff that's been tried. You could think of the 20th century in some ways as a sort of test of different economic ideas and what works and what doesn't work and what the effects are. And the problem about the economic realm, unlike maybe other realms of God's created reality, is that it's initially counterintuitive. So that we might think, because we know in the moral life, why we do something and what we do is both important, we might think the same thing is true in economics. Unfortunately, the effects of an economic policy are the same, whatever your motives for supporting it. So that means we're going to have to do something other than just sort of thinking theological principles. So let me take one quick principle to say how I think that we would do this. Let's take it that there's some principle that we could say we are our brother's keeper. I think it's complicated, and we have to take account of the fact that we have different concentric circles of responsibility. But, I mean, even Cain said, am I my brother's keeper? He didn't say, am I this guy's keeper I've never heard of. And so there's a particularity to that. But we could say something like clearly, biblically, there's a mandate for Christians, in particular, to care about those who are unable to help themselves, the poor, the widows, and the orphans, in the sort of biblical idiom. And that we as Christians, God cares about those people, God cares about the sojourner and the poor and the orphan, and he expects us to care too. But if we're doing that, okay, that doesn't really solve a whole lot of what we want to know, because I think in general, Christians have agreement on these kinds of things. I've certainly never gotten anybody that's argued this particular point with me. But we have to distinguish aspirations from principles and prudential judgment. An aspiration is just, I wish that no one ever died of AIDS in the continent of Africa. I wish that all poverty was eradicated. That's an aspiration. A principle is something like, all human beings are made in the image of God and have inherent rights and value and dignity. And so we should care for them even if we don't think that they're useful or smart or attractive. They still have that value. That's a principle. The prudential judgment comes in here. Prudence means seeing the world as it actually is and acting accordingly. And so what that means, if we want to exercise and sort of implement our principles in the economic realm, then we have to use prudential judgment. And that means that these activities and these policies, these principles, are going to get refracted through this economic domain, this part of reality. And so that's how I'd say we could, lots of Christians could be together, and we could all agree on this principle that say we ought to be concerned about the lowest income group of the population, or we ought to be concerned about the lowest skilled workers and what to do about it. But they're different policies, right? I mean, one person might say, let's raise the minimum wage to $20. Someone else says, let's raise it to $50. And somebody else says, let's not have any minimum wage. How do you decide? Well, you're not going to decide at the level of the principle. You decide by the interaction of the principle with economic reality. And when you've got that feedback, when you take on board the art of economics, and you use that to apply the principle, you're much more likely to find a policy that actually helps people. So that's my sort of simple conclusion is just this, that if we want to succeed in our pursuit of the common good in the economic realm, we must take account of economic reality. Thank you very much.
Okay, we're going to have a 10-minute response statement next from Jim Wallis. If you've got any questions that you want to be considered, feel free to write those down and pass them into the aisles, to the outside aisles. Thank you.
Well, I'm going to take the word response more than debate. I want to respond more than to debate. So I was struck when you're making disciples, it reminded me of a terrific story that I think you might want to know here. When I was at Trinity, a long time ago, we got into a confrontation with Bill Bright, Campus Crusade for Christ. He became involved in the first sort of effort to organize the religious right, and we raised that in our publication, and he was pretty angry for a long time. And then it was one of those broken relationships, but years later, I noticed that he and I were staying in the same hotel once in Florida. So I called him up and said, let's go for a walk. We went for a walk on the beach, and a long walk. And Bill said, you know, Jim, how are the poor doing now? And I said, well, they're struggling. He said, I'm a Great Commission guy. I said, yeah, I know, Bill. and I realized now that making disciples of all nations includes, that text goes on, teaching them to observe whatever I have commanded you. And he commanded us, Jesus did, to care for the poor and help to end poverty. So I want to say that I'm for that now, and I want to help you in doing that. And the day Bill Bright died, I got the message in the papers, and a check came in that day. It was a check from Bill Bright, $1,000 for Sojourners, to help us in our ministry to the poor. One of the last things he did before he died was to write a check because we agreed on the Great Commission in the end. So I'm with you on that, making disciples of all nations. You know the Bible series, the History Channel Bible series, you've been watching that during Lent, the whole series on the Bible. My kids, young people love that kind of drama, so we watched it. And Mark and Roma, who did it, sent me some tapes beforehand to comment on them. And I love the one, if you saw it, Jesus is walking into the water and he gets into the boat with Peter, and Peter casts his net over the side and there's no fish, he said, but all of a sudden it's full of fish. And Peter says, how'd you do that? And Jesus doesn't answer. He says, follow me and I'll make you a fisher of people. And Peter asks a great question. He says, what are we going to do? I love that. What are we going to do? And the Jesus character in the TV series says, change the world. Change the world. So Mark and Roma came to D.C. to a premiere before it went on the air, and they sat down with me and they said, did we get that right about changing the world? It's not in the text, but isn't that what he's trying to do? And I said, yeah, you got it right. We went through Matthew 4, 5, 6, and 7 about the inbreaking of the new order, the kingdom of God is to change the world and us with it. That's what I believe the gospel of the kingdom is. And so common good is about how how we're doing with that in the societal sphere. And I love Catholic social teaching on this. Again, we're both quoting it. It says public authorities have the common good as their prime responsibility. The common good holds government accountable, not the other way around. The common good holds government accountable. And it says, going on, the principle behind the relationship is between the different layers of the community of communities. And what that means is public sector, civil society, creative partnerships, families, congregations, all of that, national and international bodies. All of this, he says, in a centralized society, subsidiarity will mainly mean passing powers downward, can also mean passing powers upward, even to an international body, if that would better serve the common good and protect the rights of families and individuals. The NAE statement says, evangelicals believe that government is a gift from God for the common good. So the question is, how do we hold government accountable? I agree with that. How do we hold the market accountable as well? I would also add that. I do go to the World Economic Forum at Davos every year, and let me just say that until the meltdown, they had people like me and Muhammad Yunus come and speak at 7 a.m. on the fourth floor. Then the meltdown hit in 2008. 2009, we had plenary session. The market and values. Tony Blair was on the panel with me that day and said they must be in crisis. They're having a panel on the market and values at Davos, and they asked you to speak. So I asked this, I said, what do you do when the invisible hand, you know, Adam Smith, Wealth of Nations, the invisible hand of the market, what do you do when the invisible hand lets go of the common good? What do you do? Adam Smith, in The Moral Sentiments, previous book, The Wealth of Nations, talks about that the market, capitalism, won't work unless there's a moral framework that's operative. Joseph Schumpeter, an Austrian economist, says, without ethics, the market will end up devouring everything and even, finally, itself in the end. And that's what happened in 2008. I've got friends who are traders at banks on Wall Street, and they say things to me like this. They say, when financial markets were 12 to 15% of corporate profits, we were facilitating a productive capitalism. When we're now 47% of corporate profits, money just making money, like a gambling casino, something has gone terribly wrong. And the greatest benefit from the government went to Wall Street banks, bailed them out, and they're doing terrific now. The rest of us are not doing so well. So how do we hold the market accountable to the common good? In Davos, there's a real interest in this conversation about morality. You said the art of economics. I would say the morality of economics is also a great interest at Davos. And so whenever we have a session on morality and markets or ethics or values, it's packed out, often by young entrepreneurs who are doing business to solve social problems. So Muhammad Yunus, Grameen Bank, he won the Nobel Prize for that in Bangladesh. He's using business methodologies to solve problems like water, infant mortality, to serve the common good. Not just philanthropy, he's using business. So we had all the CEOs in the room, the two of us, and they were all just eating out of his hand because he was saying, here's how we use business to solve problems. And he's making payroll, you know, he's doing all the things you have to do in business. But then he said, but then we take our profits and we ply them back into the next business to solve the next problem. And we don't have executive compensation like people are used to. And they said, whoop, time for lunch, you know. One last thing about who our neighbor is. A lot of this book is about this question of the neighbor. 2 minutes, I see that. I'll be quick. So a Washington lawyer says to Jesus, who is my neighbor? I think it was a Washington lawyer. And he didn't say it like, who is my neighbor? I want to help. It's like, who is my neighbor? I want to avoid responsibility for my neighbor. Jesus tells the story of the Good Samaritan. A man's hurt down on the ground, and somebody who's from a different ethnic group, class, and region helps him out. Do like he's doing. So I'm in a meeting about the Congo, about dirty minerals. Minerals that are called dirty because they're all needed for our cell phones, and the money's being used to support warlords who are pillaging their people, raping, killing, and the room's full of NGOs and CEOs, and I said, take out your cell phones. I'm the religious lunch speaker, meaning I'm supposed to inspire them over their bad sandwiches. And so I said, no, take them out, really. And so he took them out. I said, this is your significant other. You spend more time with this than anything else, anybody else in your life. Whose ever lives are impacted by your cell phone, making your cell phone, I would say those people are your neighbors. The Good Samaritan goes global. What does it mean to turn supply chains into value chains? And they stop eating. And for a good 2 hours, we had a great conversation about how businesses are now asking how to turn supply chains into value chains. Because I think this notion of our neighbor extends beyond now our bubble. So we have to ask, are we loving our neighbor? Do we even know our neighbors? Even know who they are? Are we engaged with them? Do we know our poor neighbor? If you don't know your poor neighbor, I know Chicago, your poor neighbor is not very far away from here, okay? Do you love your undocumented neighbor? I'm on a book tour. My room's cleaned every night by undocumented neighbors in hotels. Do I love my Muslim neighbor? What does that mean, to love my Muslim neighbor? Am I loving my neighbors? That's really the spiritual question, but it also becomes, I think, a political and an economic question as well. Thank you.
Well, I was trying to figure out, okay, what are we going to disagree on? Because these are responses, and so we haven't quite sort of done that. And so, but I thought I'll just sort of give some responses to some of the things that Jim said that sort of sparked thoughts in my own mind. And the first one, hinted with the Good Samaritan. And, you know, this is the sort of question, is that people say, well, yeah, my neighbor, because I said something earlier. I said that I'm more responsible for my children, right, than some guy in the Philadelphia phone book, and I'm more responsible for my children than a child somewhere that I don't know anything about and can't affect in any way. So does that mean I'm just responsible for my child and I have no moral responsibility to that child? No, not at all. It's just that when the spheres get larger in terms of our concern, our particular knowledge falls away, right? When your child, you're the one that knows that your daughter has a peanut allergy and that she cut her knee when she was 3 years old and all these specific things about her. If you're thinking about children in general and you're trying to put policy together, you don't have that kind of particularity. But just because our experience is particular, that doesn't mean that our responsibility is sort of limited to the people that we're right next to. And in fact, it's funny, the Good Samaritan story is fascinating because when Jesus tells it, of course, you have the man that's molested and robbed at the side of the road, and you know, a publican and a priest comes by, and then the despised Samaritan comes by, and he pays for the man, takes him to an inn, and pays and says, I'll pay the rest of the bill later, essentially. But what does Jesus say? Because you think he's trying to tell you who your neighbor is, and that's part of it, right? And so he's hoping to, at least the point is that, you know, people that maybe are not like you are also your neighbor. But what does he say? He says, who is the good neighbor? And it being the Samaritan. So again, reverse the question. The question's not so much, who's my neighbor, is what does it mean if I'm the good neighbor, right? What are my responsibilities to others? And that sort of universalizes it, because it means that, especially depending upon our walk in life, the things that we do can actually affect people all over the place. And this is one of the reasons I focus on economic policy, because I think poverty and poverty alleviation and economic realities are so profoundly important. They're at the sort of bottom of Maslow's hierarchy of needs, right? And we know, because some societies are wealthier than others, the wealth can be created and there are things that we can do to make things better. And so the question is, how do we sort of implement those things so that we can help whole communities and countries that don't have that? And to do that, though, I think that we do have to penetrate some sort of basic economic realities. So let me sort of focus on, Jim, you quoted, and I forget where the quote was from, but the all are responsible for all. I'm forgetting where that's from. Yeah, I'm just trying to remember which document it is, if it's Gaudium et Spes, or I'm forgetting, but this is, I noticed this is not the one I quoted. Now, if you're not Catholic, just so you know, if something can be in a Catholic sort of social teaching document, it doesn't mean it's doctrine, right? It's not the same thing as the Trinity. But it's a sort of development of these themes. And so I talked about the common good in a way that I think is sort of defensible. I think that, you know, all are responsible for all, that's so vague that it's not clear what it means. I mean, if what that means is that, yes, we have responsibility for our fellow human beings wherever they are, absolutely. But we don't want to think that our responsibilities are not particular. That's the point of subsidiarity, which Jim alluded to very briefly. Subsidiarity is this moral principle that says society is sort of set up in terms of different, sometimes concentric and overlapping spheres. You've got a sphere of the family, and there's the sphere of your neighborhood and your parish and your church and state government and the Kiwanis Club. All these are different sort of spheres. The principle of subsidiarity says that if something can be handled at sort of the lowest jurisdiction, that's where you want it handled. It's only when you have failure there that you move up to the next jurisdiction. So for instance, we assume all things being equal that children will feed and raise their and shelter their children. What happens when the family breaks down? Well, then other spheres, whether it be charities or churches or city government, they step in, but they step in because of the breakdown at the lower level. What that means is subsidiarity is not a, it's not a way to make our commitment to the common good or to our fellow human beings mute. It's to take account of the fact that we are limited. Our knowledge and our time are limited. We have a certain amount of time on this earth. We have particular people that we deal with. And so I think we do good, though we want to think about the common good in a sort of, ultimately, I think, a global sense. We don't want to lose sight of the sort of particularities. And then, oh, 5 minutes. Oh, hey, great. So then maybe I'll raise one thing, because Jim mentioned the financial crisis. And I think this is a wonderful test case for what I was talking about, that our goal needs to be to integrate the sort of relevant moral and theological truths of the faith. Not just the moral truths, right? The Imago Dei, that's an ontological claim about what human beings are. It's the most, probably the most important economic category. But we want to integrate those things with the empirical discoveries and the theoretical insights of economics. In doing that, that sounds simple, but very often, even in the way we think about particular events, we are already kind of importing certain assumptions, economic assumptions, that are quite debatable. So the financial crisis, I'll mention this, because this, I happen to be just finished a book on this that comes out this summer. The financial crisis is extraordinarily complicated. But this kind of official story initially was this is largely the result of sort of greed and avarice, especially centered in Wall Street and in banks and in those institutions dealing with finances. Well, my colleague George Gilder says that, you know, saying greed causes a financial crisis is like saying gravity causes plane crashes, right? It's always there. Gravity is the universal. So what we want to do is isolate the variable. Why did we have a financial crisis that was rooted in mortgages and mortgage-backed securities and not, say, in commodities futures or in energy futures or in a technology, right? It's the same people investing in all those kinds of things. We can presume that, you know, greed and avarice are kind of well distributed among the human population. This isn't to deny that greed's not a sort of, you know, a contributing factor, but it's almost always a contributing factor. It's to, I think, point out that there was something more going on in the political and policy context of the mortgage market that is the key decisive factor that I think caused it to happen. The reason it happened in the housing market, and it didn't happen, say, in commodities futures, is because it's a series of very well-meaning policies over about 25 years called affordable housing goals that were, there's actually 25 different programs in different sort of government institutions. And the goal was, look, home ownership's a good thing. People are better take care of their houses. They are more involved in their community if they own homes. So let's do what we can to help lower income people own homes. That sounds great. And it, you know, if you do sort of study the home ownership statistics, that sounds like a wonderful thing to do. The problem was is that the policy ended up degrading the underwriting standards on a loan and the types of underwriting standards that you get on a loan in a normal market. I would argue that we weren't dealing with the invisible hand of the market here. The market, as I mean, it's not anarchy. It's a context in which you have rule of law. People don't kill or steal or defraud each other, not allowed to. And then it creates a context for free economic exchange. Well, in 2007, people were getting ninja loans. Ninja stands for no income, no job or assets. So you could get a loan even without an income or assets. In some cases in California, you could even get what were called negative amortization loans. You could get a loan in which you're actually getting further and further in debt. You don't even sort of pay the interest, let alone the principal. Well, this is a very strange thing, but the fact that people could get $400,000 loans from banks without any documentation and without any sort of clear means of income or without a substantial down payment tells you something weird happened to that market. That's not how any normal functioning market will work. And so what happened is that the federal government created a market for risky loans, so much so that Fannie Mae, the government-sponsored enterprise, that one of the ones that they buy loans on the secondary market. So, you know, you might be a banker, you give somebody a mortgage, and then you can sell that mortgage to Fannie Mae or Freddie Mac. In 2001, Fannie Mae had a government-imposed quota of 50% for lower income and high-risk loans that they had to give. So in other words, 50% of the loans that they purchased that year had to come from this low-income and generally high-risk category. Fannie Mae had switched from being the sort of definer of a prime loan and a stable loan, which had helped millions of people, to actually creating a perverse market that many private actors and public actors followed in the housing market, and that ultimately led to a crisis. But that wasn't, I don't think, the result of the market working as it ought to or it should have. It was a result of very well-meaning, misguided policies supported in a bipartisan fashion. I mean, President Bush implemented these policies with as much zeal as anyone before him. All well-meaning, but misguided because they didn't take account of the subtle incentive structure of how loans would normally take place. And so when they broke that, they sort of destroyed the information chain of the mortgage market. So with that, I will end. Thank you.
Okay, well, we're moving, like I said before, moving into something a little less formal where they're coming to the podium. I'd invite them to stay seated if they like, or stand if they feel they have something profound enough to stand for, I'd say. I would ask them to think about at this point responding to one another, in particular if they have questions of one another. And where do you perceive your, I don't want to say weaknesses, but where do you think there may be challenges to the position that the other person would hold on this issue? And so I'll start with Jim. You can continue on as you like, or ask Jay a question.
Probably a good thing to say at an evangelical South Seminary. I believe in sin. I believe it's real. And on the political right and left, the one side, it's a bit of a caricature, but the left sometimes acts like they believe in sinless government. And the right thinks they believe in sinless markets. And C.S. Lewis said the reason he was for democracy was not because people are so good, but because they're not often so good. And you need checks and balances with power. So I think that we won't have time to talk about the financial crisis tonight. But the behavior of banks, I know traders at Goldman Sachs who told me that what they did was unethical, immoral, and illegal. They were, in fact, fined for illegal behavior. And I know bankers, regional bankers, who didn't do what the Wall Street banks did. They didn't put together all their mortgage capital into bad asset packages, even though they were told to make them a lot of money. They said, well, we have these old ideas of our relationship to customers that are important to us, and so we won't do that. And one of my friends who wouldn't do it ended up on Fortune magazine cover Banker of the Year because he wasn't impacted by all this. Other banks did that. And, the rule of law is important here, but the rule of law changed. from 1980s on, when big corporations and banks really changed the laws and regulations. There used to be a law that you couldn't invest your mortgage capital. And now they just changed that law. And so they begin to do risky investments of mortgage capital. And that's a big part of why it failed. So rule of law was changed by Wall Street. They paid for the candidates' campaigns, and then they literally wrote those laws on the floor of the Senate. So I want to talk about sinless. I don't believe in sinless markets or sinless government. So I think the common good has to hold both responsible.
Yeah, I agree. I don't know quite what sinless markets is. I assume you mean that people do things in the market that are sinful, and groups and companies can do sort of immoral things. When I talk about the market, what I'm referring to, you know, there's these words, capitalism and free enterprise, and they can be impediments, I think, to understanding. When I'm talking about a market, I'm talking about a social setting with very specific social and cultural and moral and legal sort of prerequisites, which sets up the conditions for free exchange. But the nature of a free exchange in that context, it's entirely my relationship to the Apple Corporation, for instance. It's a monster of a corporation. It's one of the largest in the world, right? It's not predator and prey, right? I'm not coerced by Apple. I go into an Apple store, and they dutifully want to sort of help me. And that's what I think a healthy market sort of creates. So the market, in many ways, is just the sort of aggregate of people's free decisions and the order that emerges from that when you have a context of rule of law. I'm not saying that emerges when you've got sort of anarchy. And so the question is always, you know, rule of law refers, we know the kind of core, but okay, we talk about rules and regulations. And so the question is, okay, how do you decide if a regulation makes sense, or is it, you know, is it sort of the state stepping in and doing something that's stupid? I would just say the best rule of thumb is when the benefits outweigh the costs on a regulation. And if you do that, that's sort of exercising the art of economics. You actually end up solving the problem. Let me just then address Jim's one objection. He referred to a particular deregulation, and he's right. There was a law, a Depression-era law called Glass-Steagall, that set up several sort of requirements that banks had that one part of it was taken down. And what it was this idea that banks could either be sort of mortgage or investment banks, but not both. And so investment mortgage banks and regular banks, they couldn't merge. Well, what's funny is a number of people said, oh, this all happened because of Glass-Steagall and deregulation. The problem is, if you look at the analysts now, left, right, and center, they all agree that if anything, Glass-Steagall probably lessened the severity of the financial crisis. And what happened? Remember in those fateful months in September and October 2008, there were a number of companies that didn't fail, right? Precisely because they're able to buy, banks, regular banks were able to buy investment banks and vice versa. And so it turns out that this one deregulation, which was initially blamed for the financial crisis, probably lessened its severity. But the devil is in the details in all of these things, obviously. And that's the sort of nature of prudential judgment, is how much, you know, what do we know about this situation? What are its effects? How well do I understand it? And so I don't think we should expect that Christians should agree on all these things, precisely because we evaluate the evidence differently. But we should realize that if we're wanting to really have good prudential judgment that leads to policy, we need to pay attention to these details.
I think I was on a panel once with the CEO of PepsiCo, Indian woman, very visionary entrepreneur. And Indira once made a commitment about a year and a half ago to, her goal was that half of PepsiCo's beverages would be healthy for a change, not just sugar water, healthy beverage. And in fact, there's beverages now we're producing that if a poor child drinks one of those a day, they can get Coca-Cola to any kid in the world, right? They could give those to one kid a day and they would survive. Well, Indira wasn't at our session last year. That was because her stockholders were attacking her because they didn't think this policy would make them as much money as stockholders. And she talked about the legacy of PepsiCo, a long-term future about doing well, doing right by doing well. And here's the deal. the average length of time, Bill George told me this, he's a Harvard Business School professor and a very wealthy businessman. The average length of time for a stockholder used to be something like 2 years. And he said, now it's about 6 weeks. You've got these hedge fund guys going in and out of PepsiCo like gamblers. They have no interest in the legacy or vocation of PepsiCo or a short or a long-term goal. They just want to make money fast. And so Bill George, who's a professor of business at Harvard, said to me, I wish there could be some kind of regulation that you as a stockholder couldn't vote on policy issues like this if you hadn't been there for at least a year or 2 years. So there are regulatory questions that need to be asked, and the freedom of the market depends often, theoretically, if people have all these free choices, that's fine, but monopoly capitalism is what we often face now. One or two companies dominate markets, and people have very few choices. And so subsidiarity, I'll say this last point, Pope Benedict issued a very powerful statement in the middle of the crisis from the Vatican. It was about how the financial crisis, the behavior of the financial markets was so destructive to the common good, there maybe ought to be regulation at the international level to control the behavior of international markets. And that was from the Vatican. So he was intervening, saying subsidiarity means you go as local as you can, but when you have to go high, you go high. And when you're dealing with international capital that moves around the world, that is much more powerful than governments, where is the common good there? Who enforces the common good? So these are fair questions.
Am I?
Yeah, we have one more minute. I can start asking a few questions.
Oh, okay. I'll just respond to that briefly. Jim's exactly right. And questions of corporate governance, I think, is something that ought to be looked at. Corporate governance is not written in granite somewhere in Platonic heaven, right? And so there are types of corporate governance that I think work better than others. Ones where CEOs go in and out tend to be really bad ideas because they don't act for the long-term benefit of the company. But focus on this question of monopoly power, for instance. There's one monopoly in the United States. It's called the government. All right, the government has a unique and capacities to raise armies and use tanks and force and incarcerate people. That's not a bad thing. I'm just saying they're the monopoly. And so if you want to look at things that look like monopolies, look at the businesses that look like monopolies in the United States. And with virtually no exceptions, what you will find is companies that are very good at getting very cozy with federal regulators. This is the crony capitalism that we saw during the financial crisis is a perfect example of this, that those very well-connected large companies that are connected to the government do very well. Those are the types of monopolies that I think we should fear and we should be concerned about. The competition between Microsoft and Apple, on the other hand, I think is a different thing, and it has an entirely different sort of moral status.
Right, well, we do have quite a few questions here, and
did we get a tweet?
They're all over the map, really, but I'm going to zero in on a few specifics and see what you guys come back with. Since Jay just spoke, let me ask one for Jim here. Please explain some ways that the, quote, best big conservative idea of personal responsibility is thwarted when the common good is let go.
There's a chapter in the book about liberals and conservatives. And it says, the best conservative idea is personal responsibility. The best liberal idea is social responsibility. I think both are necessary for the common good. And yet, they're at war, the liberal-conservative battle. It's a war. And as somebody who's worked on poverty for years, I've never seen a family successfully move themselves out of poverty without taking some personal responsibility. Yet there's got to be a context and a support system for that to happen. And so rather than having a good dialogue, how do we mesh personal and social responsibility? We have this war going on between both sides. So half the chapter's on the need for civility, to have a civil conversation about what we can learn from each other, and not both sides do the same thing. They take a problem They want to make us afraid of it and then blame it on the other side, rather than saying, what are the root causes here of the problem and how do we solve it? That, I think, will take both conservative, best conservative and best liberal ideas.
I don't actually think I'm finding something I can sort of directly disagree with Jim, that describing the kind of left and right in terms of focusing on individual responsibility for social responsibility, it just doesn't hold. The pro-life movement, the pro-family movement, people that, you know, in Seattle, Washington, that get spit on for 40 days prior to Easter, that are, you know, sort of pro-life activists, they're obviously concerned with the social good. And certainly conservatives that are concerned about culture and education and all those kinds of things. I think it's just actually, it's much more complicated than that. And we should all, though, recognize that we have both individual components and also the individuals that we're created to be are individuals in community and in a social setting. And the tough thing to do is to get the balance right of those things, I think, so we actually help people rather than harm them.
Yeah, just to clarify, I'm not saying conservatives don't believe in social good. I'm saying the core idea that I think is most important is personal responsibility. And the balance, E.J. Dionne wrote a terrific book recently about how in American life we have these two traditions, individual liberty and community. They're both powerful traditions. And they have to be kept in balance for the sake of the common good. If you go too much on the common, community, collective, corporate side, you can get into a totalitarian state. We've seen that. But if you go too much for individual liberty, there are some people on the political right, on the far end, who are such libertarians that Ayn Rand is more their guide than Jesus Christ. And they don't believe in the concept of the common good. If they were here, they would say, there is no such thing as the common good. And there are people, I think, on the far left, I would call identity politics, where it's their kind of group is the criteria, not what's best for all. So I do think we're battling sometimes left and right on the common good. And so how do we find a way to, Mike Gerson and I work together on practical things all the time. We're co-chairs now of this Values Council, the World Economic Forum. Mm-hmm. And we just love to have lunch and talk because the columnists that I read in the media, I more read conservative columnists because I want people who are gonna make me think, challenge what I believe, and so as Mike and I often say, people these days mostly get their media from places that agree with their prejudices already. And that's a very dangerous thing in our society. You should go to places where you're going to be challenged in your thinking by people of a different perspective than you have. And so I think the liberal-conservative debate could become a dialogue that could really be helpful to us.
Okay, well, one of the things I'm hearing from Jim is kind of a via media approach, trying to walk a balancing act between responsibility and justice and so forth. And on your side, I thought I heard a thesis regarding prudential reasoning, that is, understanding the economic realities and other realities as they actually are. One of the questions here tries to flesh that out with an example that maybe you can help us with. If we look at economic realities and the common good, how do you deal with the economic reality of distribution of wealth? Economics is value neutral and allows people to die. How, as Christians, can we deal with the tension between the free market economies and starvation?
No, so far as I know, starvation is not a widespread problem in free market societies. In fact, we've completely eradicated famine in the West entirely. Mostly for social and economic reasons. So there is this question about economic inequality, which I'll focus on that. You could sort of frame it morally. Is it just that some people be richer than others? Or sort of more starkly, is it just that some people be rich and some people be poor? I know Jim and very few people would argue that everyone should have exactly the same income, but many of us are troubled by sort of inequality. I would argue that's actually focusing on the wrong thing. Bill Gates, I live 3 miles from Bill Gates. He's got a net worth, a million times greater than mine. It doesn't harm me in any way. In fact, I benefit from it, if anything. Why is that? Well, it's because I'm not suffering in bone-grinding poverty. Poverty is the moral concern. This were a problem. It would be like if we talked about, you know, the kind of health gap or something like that, and we thought, well, the problem is that some people are getting good medical care and some people are getting poor medical care. That's not the problem. The problem is some people are getting poor medical care. What can we do about that? And so I think very often the sort of income inequalities are a red herring. And there's a lot of kind of basic confusion in this. And any kind of statistic in income inequality is a snapshot of a moment. It's like a picture of traffic from a helicopter. The same people don't stay in those categories through time. And again, most of us actually kind of travel through them. And so I think questions of income mobility, possible is it for an ordinary person, say, that just graduates from high school, to work him or herself out of poverty? That's the question of income mobility, and that's the thing I think we should actually be focusing on. Focusing on a particular distribution at one time or another, I think actually it's a statistical myth, just as the spread in the distribution. I don't know, for instance, median incomes have stagnated since the 1980s, but I don't know that it's a moral truth that society should have a median income that's, you know, very high. What if you had a society in which everyone started out fairly poor, let's say earning $30,000 or $20,000 a year in equivalent dollars, and they worked for a couple of years and all of them were millionaires, right? Well, the income distribution would be radically skewed between the poor and the rich. That's not obviously unjust. And so I think when you're talking about inequality, you have to talk about the particulars to see if, are we dealing with a moral problem or not? And we also have to remember that we don't, not to import false understandings of an economy. Bill Gates, right, did not become a billionaire by stealing computers from homeless people, right, or software programs. The late Steve Jobs didn't get rich by stealing iPads from poor people, right? They created wealth that was not there before. And so when you have, what you want is a dynamic and wealth-creating society in which there's a lot of opportunities for income mobility. And then the fact that some people have a higher income than others, I don't think is either here nor there, though people that are wealthy, there are many warnings about from Scripture about the dangers of wealth and what we have to do with that. I think that's a relevant question.
I'll respond to that one. One time at Davos, I got asked to speak to the topic to all these CEOs. Should we despair of our disparities? And I said to them, let me take a subject that is one of your favorites, biblical archaeology. And they all laughed. And I said, when they dig down the ruins of ancient Israel, they find, this is the archaeologist, periods of time where the remnants showed not a sameness, but a relative sharing of prosperity. During those times, there are no prophets. But when they dig down and find, like, the 8th century, with great disparities, that's when the prophets rise up to thunder the judgment and justice of God. I think inequality is a biblical issue, not just poverty. For example, I'll be specific. God doesn't mind prosperity as long as it's shared. From 1945 to about 1980, we had prosperity in this country that did really, the rising tide did lift all the boats. In fact, the 20% at the bottom did quite well. That was a prosperity that was good for lots of people. From 1980 onwards, the prosperity has been very skewed toward the very top. And I think that is a serious problem. For one thing, our social mobility, I agree, social mobility opportunity is critical. We have less social mobility in this country now than Western Europe does. That's think tanks all over D.C. will tell you that. Less social mobility now. So in this book, I'd recommend to you The Spirit Level. It's a British book, how excessive inequality, even more than poverty, harms everybody in society. Countries with dramatic inequality have far more social problems, including crime, corruption, lower trust levels, and everyone's well-being is depressed. And about hunger, there's a new film out you should see called At the Table, and it shows how one of five Americans are food insecure, meaning they're hungry. One in five Americans today in this wealthy country, see the documentary, it speaks for itself, are hungry. So in wealthy countries, we have now hungry families.
I'll just say, Jim, I've heard your argument about the biblical archaeology, and I actually looked into this, and I don't buy it at all that we can figure out these highly fine-tuned economic distinctions based on sort of burn pot herds and stuff. I mean, it's just hard to learn anything from archaeology, but let's assume it's correct. Let's assume that we can establish that at times of relative inequality in, say, 1000 BC in the ancient Near East, there were greater social problems when it was unequal than when it was equal. Again, nothing follows from this, because I didn't argue that no type of inequality is morally relevant. If the type of inequality where the warlord steals everything from everybody else, that's the morally problematic kind of inequality. But as I said, even when you're sort of comparing the status of the lower quintile now compared to 1980s, they're not the same people. We're just talking about a distribution. And on almost any objective measure, even people in the lower, the sort of lowest quintile, and you're right, that statistic of, you know, about one in five people have some hunger insecurity. But we talk about hunger insecurity now. We don't talk about famine or massive starvation. That's an improvement. And so the question is, what, you know, do we want a society in which there's income mobility, in which the people even at the bottom rung of the ladder actually do better over time? It's societies which allow for income inequality, because it, frankly, that sort of mirrors the fact that we ourselves in our economic activities are unequal, and some economic activities are more valued than other. And so it doesn't follow that inequality is morally neutral in every sense. It just means that, you know, when you're dealing in a market economy and you've got a wealth distribution that's unequal, that itself is, I don't think, the moral
issue. What do you do with the two prosperities? Prosperity to 1980, which was good for most people. Prosperity since has not been good for most people.
I'm not quite sure what that means, but I know on any particular economic measures, people, even with the financial crisis, people generally live in larger houses now than they did. We have much greater, if you think of wealth as means, for instance, how do you calculate the value that I can talk to my daughters tonight and you could talk to your kids in DC and look at each other on a phone, right? That's the result of human ingenuity and creativity. None of that existed in 1980. And so there's a huge number of factors that you'd have to sort of take account of to figure out whether, say, the average person in the lowest fifth of the sort of income distribution was worse off or better off. I do think that in some cases we are worse off now, but I don't think it's primarily an economic thing. I think it's the destruction of families and communities and things like that.
But that's part of why we're, like, I think marriage is in serious trouble in this country. And I agree with conservatives who say marriage is an anti-poverty measure. I've said that time and time again. But one of the reasons that marriage is in trouble is middle-class people, are wages are stagnating, have been for a long time, except at the top. If you're not making a living family wage, if you're working two and three jobs, that's hard to support a family and take care of your kids. So people, we often in places like this are disconnected from an awful lot of people who are really struggling in this country and don't think that their access to technology changes that. They're really struggling with survival, and their family life is suffering because they lack the money to pay for a family wage. That's a serious problem that we should deal with. And the wages at the top are skyrocketing. And at some point, and Bill Gates, you know, who is used for him as an example, I've talked to Bill Gates about this. And Bill Gates is in Washington, D.C. on a regular basis to say, trying to get the U.S. government to invest tax dollars in public health here on our own, because the richest foundation in the world can't do it by itself. So he's always pressing government to make public investments in things like education and public health. The kids in neighborhoods I've lived in most of my life go to schools that are really, you should call them prisons, because they imprison kids in poverty. And that's not true in neighborhoods like, I went to seminary here, and I work with high school kids here, and they were in a great school. But I just came from Chicago today, in the South Side, and that's not the case. And so, you know, education, a criminal incarceration system that's imprisoning men of color unequally because they're black and brown, that's a fact. The stats all show that, and that makes marriage more difficult in poor communities. So let's look at the social economic factors that make marriage and family very difficult.
I'd like to respond to that briefly. Just let's think about it for a minute here. Do you think the average American is better off now than in 1930, economically? Obviously, yeah, Jim, and you know that. There's virtually no divorce in 1930. In fact, there was very little until sort of 1960. It's clear to me that, of course, if you have financial difficulties, that's often listed as one of the sort of main causes of divorce, that can sort of create tensions that can lead to the breakdown of marriages. But that clearly isn't the primary cause, because societies that are desperately poor nevertheless have a healthy marriage culture. And so something other than the particular stagnating wages of the middle class, I think, is to blame for the destruction of marriage. And it's a complicated and important thing.
Well, the average American, though, isn't better off now than they were in the 1960s and 70s. The stagnating wages, this is the first generation now where kids are not going to do as well as their parents. That's where we are now. That's a new situation. 1930s, one thing. But 60s and 70s, we were doing better with our distribution of prosperity than we are now.
Average and median are different things. You're citing median income. That's the ones that have the most in the middle. Those have stagnated. I don't think average incomes, adjusting for inflation, have gone down. Certainly not if you take account of things that are economic benefits we have that aren't counted in income. But these are specific empirical claims and assertions that we're making that ought to be decided based on the facts, right? Not on, based on how we feel, but based on what do the statistics really show? What does it mean to have income inequality? These are all kind of empirical questions, and I think that's the way finally we would come to an agreement or disagreement
on. The better way to resolve them, though, empirically, is to go and meet the families who are struggling. Poverty rate's the highest in this country in 50 years. And if we had more proximity to poor people as Christians, and when Christians have proximity to poor people, they change their views time and time again. So changing our proximity and being involved with people who are poor, lower middle class, struggling, working class, that's where the suffering really is now. And check out the movie At the Table. Just watch it and see what you think.
Fascinating discussion of the particulars.
We finally found
here.
Something to disagree on robustly.
Let's see. I've got one fellow here managed to put his name on here, and he works here at Trinity. His name's Bill Mulder, New Testament scholar. Kind of an ironic question, but one I think that tries to bring us back together here. How can a church as divided as the American church speak with a common voice to the common good of the nation? Doesn't our divisiveness undermine our credibility? How can we foster Christian unity and a united Christian voice across denominations and boundaries within the church?
Let me start with that. I think we lose credibility, quite frankly, if we are sort of act in terms of rancor and our anger. And so I want to distinguish, though, between sort of honest disagreement about things in which you're making arguments back and forth and respecting people, and you might think somebody's wrong about something. I don't think that's a bad thing. And in fact, I think, if anything, we ought to, as Christians, be trying to model that kind of disagreement in which we assume, ignorance before malice, as it's put. Don't always assume somebody has bad motives. Assume that maybe they don't understand something, and if they assume the same about you, things are really much better off. I do think that it's difficult to say how does the church as a whole speak, because when the Pope in Rome, in his windy Wednesday address, he says something. He's not sort of speaking in terms of dogma for the whole church, and that's in the Catholic context. It's very difficult to sort of do that. And so how would we as a Christian community as a whole, sort of church writ large, how would we do that? I think that it's wiser that we focus on those things that are our core principles that we share, and that we respect the divergence of opinions on prudential judgments and policy. So in other words, I think that I'm very interested in immigration reform, as Jim is, but I won't go into the sort of details of that. I think we definitely have to do something. But, there are really difficult debates in immigration about how you weigh the cultural and the sort of economic issues. And so I think what we would, as a church, want to talk about in there primarily is to say, look, what we're concerned about is our fellow human beings, including those that are not citizens that are living among us for various reasons. We need to do something about that. And if we can do that, people that, you know, sort of know things about policy can sort of can weigh these things out. But I think it would be it's a mistake for a large church body to speak on something that's not their expertise. You know, any particular commission doesn't necessarily have expertise on, you know, some particular economic question, but presumably if they're representing a Christian church, they should be able to speak at the level of fundamental principles that we ought to be concerned with and that which have political and economic implications.
The principle that I think is most important to do that, that can bring us together and that can shape policy, like Jay's saying, the principle is, I think as Christians, we always must be the ones who are asking about what's happening to the poorest and most vulnerable. The biblical prophets make clear that the righteousness of a nation is determined by that, not by its gross national product, not by its military supremacy, or not even by its culture being the envy of the world. It's how we treat the poorest and most vulnerable. So in a meeting with the President of the United States, he's on one side of the table, and it's about the debt crisis and how to resolve it. Our team had the Roman Catholic bishops, it had the National Association of Evangelicals, Salvation Army. I mean, this was not a religious left group. This is a whole wide body of Christ here, Bread for the World, Sojourners. And the bishop was quite powerful in saying to the president, he said, Mr. President, the scripture that compels our obedience, that obliges us to be here today, does not say, as you've done to the middle class, you've done to me. It says, as you've done to the least of these, you've done to me. And the president said, I know that text. and he does. Then I said, that means that in these deficit budget decisions, you need to protect poor and low-income people. You can't reduce the deficit by increasing poverty. And we, in fact, I'll just say, off the record, in that meeting, I said, you need to exempt low-income entitlements from the sequester. It's a year and a half ago. Because I said, the sequester is going to go into effect. It's going to go because you all won't reach agreement, and you've got to exempt low-income entitlements from the sequester. And they said no, the White House. An hour later, they called and said that they would. But we'd also have meetings with Ryan and Boehner. And they were told, they were spoken to by Catholic bishops who said, Catholic social teaching means you must protect low-income entitlements in the sequester. Hmm. And Boehner, off the record, Boehner and Ryan said, we won't stand for that publicly, but we won't block it if it happens. And the White House put it in, and that's why low-income entitlements are protected in the sequester. Because the faith community said, you've got to protect poor people. So that principle is also what's motivating the immigration change among evangelicals is because of a biblical conversion on the part of evangelicals who now believe the way they treat the stranger, the immigrant, is the way they treat Christ himself. And that's what's transforming the evangelical world.
I'll just jump off of what Jim says, because his argument here is the thing that I was intending to sort of disagree with, actually, in my initial presentation. Absolutely, the moral principle, I completely agree that God is concerned about the poorest of the poor, and you sort of evaluate the economics of a society, not by how many rich people there are, or how many, you know, relative rich people, the middle income people there are, but what's the state of the poor in that society, and compare it to sort of other possible states that they could be in. And that's the kind of key moral question. That's the principle, right? But Jim switched from that to, I know the meeting that you're talking about, to focusing on very particular policies. And you can't go straight from, we need to be concerned about the poor, to you need to preserve the sort of programs that I think help the poor without really additional argument that they're the best programs to help the poor. That's the dilemma. We have a huge debt crisis, and in fact, the crisis is going to come because of middle-class entitlements, you know, Social Security and Medicare and Medicaid, but we should not identify the key moral principles, whether Catholic bishops or at the National Association of Evangelicals, we need to not identify our core principles with specific policies, unless we make the argument clear. They're not the same thing. Saying we should be concerned for women and children, it doesn't follow automatically that we should increase funding for aid to families with dependent children, for instance, or something. You got to work out what are the actual effects of those policies. Do they actually help the people, or are there better ways to help them in those sites?
Right, but to be fair to the bishops who think pretty clearly about these things, the Catholic bishops and I would agree with that principle. You don't take a principle and then just say, this means this in policy. But you have to try to apply principles to policy choices. And we have, and this team was a circle of protection. We have spent lots of time talking about how programs have to be evaluated to see if they really do help poor people. And we don't support everything that's a program unless it really makes a difference in the lives of poor people. So the bishops are very careful. I'm careful not to say this principle means these 10 policies. But in a meeting on the debt crisis, I'm telling you, here's what you're in a meeting with a very famous Democratic senator who's one of the Gang of Eight, who's a bridge builder. And I'll say to him, Senator, you and I could find 12 senators, Republican and Democrat, who could sit at your table here, and they could find a path to fiscal sustainability. I agree that entitlement reform is critical to that. The Democrats often don't, I do, okay? In a way that protects poor people. But he says, yes, we could do that, those senators. And they could protect the principle, I asked him, of protecting poor people in that path to fiscal sustainability. He says, yes, we could. But then the interests would come into the room, all the interests. And those interests would demand their expenditures on them remain, and the poor would suffer, wouldn't they, Senator? He says, yes, that's what would happen. So our job in the fiscal debate is to protect the people who have no lobbyists to protect them. There are 3 pharmaceutical company lobbyists for every single member of Congress. That's one industry. And there are not large lobbying groups on K Street for poor moms and kids. So the faith community is saying, you gotta protect the principle. And when our experience in Catholic charities and parish work tells us that these nutrition programs are critical to keep millions more from falling into poverty, the bishops say, protect those programs.
Someone on Twitter, Jim, worries that you are potentially conflating church action and political action. Is there a difference between those two things in your mind, and what is it?
Well, the church has to lead by example. And I always, for years, sojourners from when we were first here, has talked about how the church has to lead by doing what we say we believe. But also the church has to be prophetic. In other words, Wilberforce didn't just say in England, I don't think Christians should own slaves. He said, I think we should end slavery in the UK. That took parliamentary decision-making. It took 30 years to do that. And Wilberforce died 3 days later because his work was done. King didn't say, I don't think Christians should just not discriminate. He said, Jim Crow, segregation is wrong. Denying black people the right to vote because they're black is wrong. Mm-hmm. So, and King never said, this is important, King never said, I get to win because I'm a Christian in a Judeo-Christian country. He never said that. He said, I have to win the debate, the public debate about what's best for the common good, that civil rights and voting rights are good not just for black Baptists and Jews, but for all Americans. So we have to win that debate, but it's got to come out of our leading by example. You've got to show what we mean by what we do. But we don't have to limit our activity to just rescuing women and kids from the traffickers. We can also go after what's causing trafficking and challenge those behaviors, policies, laws, banks that are making it possible. So it's both.
Yeah, I agree with Jim on this. I mean, obviously, there's different things that the church as a whole does and that Christians in particular do, but, you know, politics and dealing with in the political sphere and in the economic sphere, I think that's part of our mandate. Now, we don't want to, obviously, when I'm sort of advocating for immigration reform, that's not the same thing as if I'm, you know, sort of somebody's preaching the gospel on the mission field. Those are different activities. But I think that we both agree that all these things ought to be understood in terms of a pursuit of the common good. So, don't, you know, this was the kind of the cliche in the 80s when I grew up was that, well, you know, don't get involved in politics or try to apply your faith to politics. That's just politicizing the gospel. Well, it's possible to politicize the gospel, but just because you're trying to apply the gospel to politics in the public square doesn't mean you're politicizing it. You may just be trying to work out the implications of it. And so that's a warning to all of us. We don't want our political ideas to sort of dictate what we think God is like or something like that. We want to work out carefully what we think God is like and therefore how he sort of expects us as individuals in a society to function.
I'm going to ask one more question and I'll give you guys a chance to wrap up. Most of this has been focused on the common good of people in the United States, including the poor. What if this conflicts with the common good of other nations and ideologies and so forth? So I think it's particularly poignant in light of the fact that, you know, the poor are international as well. I mean, should we be prepared to give up quite a lot in order to help the poor, but then have an international scene in which, you know, economics ultimately breaks down because of that?
Well, I guess I would argue that if the actual common good is not in conflict, now it may be that a nation's perceived interest conflict with those, you know, those in other countries or something like that. But I think if we take the common good as the Christian tradition has described it, that it takes account of the social settings that allow individuals and families and associations to pursue and fulfill their own perfection, that's got universal applicability. It's just like what Jim said about Dr. King or Wilberforce. We hold these ideas with universal intent. We don't think just that Christians or Baptists or Catholics are made in the image of God, but absolutely everyone. The question is, you know, sort of like, say, let's just focus on the economic question, because I think the questioner was thinking of that. What kinds of arrangements best help other countries? And a widespread assumption, if you read Gustavo Gutierrez's first editions of his Theology of Liberation, he argued that the South was mostly poor because of the wealth of the United States. In other words, the wealth, we were hoarding it up here and depriving it of people south of the border. Even Gutierrez later said, oh, I was mistaken about that. In fact, there's very little interaction economically at the time between the North and the South. And the reality is that in a market, because markets, if they're working properly, have to do a free exchange in which we try to produce goods and services that have value to other people, countries, the United States gets wealthy by trading with Japan and China and Western Europe. It doesn't follow that because we got wealthy, it causes Japan to get poorer. That's not actually how it works. What we want, if anything, is those countries that are not fully sort of in the market to be able to participate, to bring them in. But I think it's one of my sort of the economic myths that I talk about is this idea of the zero-sum game, that if the United States is wealthy or the average American is wealthy, that causes the poverty of someone else. Now, that can be, right? But don't think that way. Because of the fact that wealth is created, what we want is for poor countries, insofar as it's possible, to be able to have the same conditions that richer countries do to create wealth for themselves.
There's a chapter here called The Beloved Community Welcomes All the Tribes. And so I have a whole section here on the dangers of the notion of American exceptionalism. I'll let you reread that, but American exceptionalism, and I love this country in particular ways, and I say why in this book, but we shouldn't make exceptions on ethics for our country when we aren't behaving properly. And while I agree with that last statement about how do we allow cotton farmers in sub-Saharan Africa to really have a chance to lift themselves out of poverty. Mm. Well, sometimes international trade rules make it difficult to do that. So the new president of the World Bank, who I like a lot, we had a conversation recently, and he wants to work with the churches because he's more than any previous World Bank president wanting to ask, what can the World Bank, sometimes World Bank so-called structural adjustments, have really made it much more difficult for poor countries mm-hmm. to lift themselves out of poverty, because they've been enforcing, when you enforce the well-being of the wealthy, there are more cell phones in Africa now than there ever have been before. That's a wonderful thing for overcoming poverty. That's a good thing of how the market has spread cell phones. But sometimes our policies, the World Bank, IMF, have made it more difficult for poor countries to lift themselves out. So let's challenge those, as the new World Bank president wants to do. And so the preference, where Gutierrez was right, was the preference for the poor. What is the biblical preference mm-hmm. for the poor? And then asking what that means. So I think it does mean, I was at a debate with Dinesh D'Souza, who's a very conservative fellow, and we were at a Christian college campus in the Midwest, and it was about American exceptionalism. And the crowd clearly, before we started, agreed with Dinesh's politics more than mine on the war in Iraq or Afghanistan. But I started by saying, well, we're all Christians here, right? We're all evangelical Christians. He says, yes. So then we all are going to say from the start that we're Americans first. No? Oh, we're Christians first and Americans second, right? And you could just feel how much they disagreed with what I had just said, but they couldn't disagree with it. They had to agree, but they wanted to be, and their political inclinations were, Americans first. And Dinesh D'Souza is clearly an America first guy. I said, as Christians, we can't do that. The body of Christ is a global community. It's not an American community. And we are Christians first and Americans down the road after that. And that's a very radical idea.
Well, we are pretty much out of time. I'm going to take that as your final statement. Would you like to have a final minute here?
I almost, that's so good. I honestly want to just let it sit there. But I think that's exactly right. But I hope that, you know, we've tried to model some of the things that we've been talking about, is that it's possible. In fact, it's important. I don't think we should regret the fact that politicians in Washington, D.C. disagree on things. We regret when there's rancor or when the disagreement's not an honest intellectual disagreement. What we want to do, though, is to, you know, discover these things together. And so I think for sort of lowering the heat among Christians, especially with contentious economic and political ideas, let's just try to be careful to distinguish between the underlying principles that we ought to agree on, and maybe in some cases we don't want to agree, but yeah, who can deny that we're Christians first and Americans second, those core principles, and then realize that, okay, well, we may be disagreeing about what policy best helps the poor, not because one of us loves the poor and one of us hates the poor, but because we evaluate the evidence or the economic situation or the economic realities differently. Doesn't mean to each his own. I mean, I think there are true or false answers to those things, but it's important to realize where the difficulty lies and where it doesn't.
So do you think we've had a civil debate tonight?
Well, thank you guys for coming out in this weather and this late evening. Jim Wallis is going to be staying on for a little while, signing books out there in the foyer. And you've got one of those, or like to pick one up, I'm sure he has one for you out there. Thank you both of these. Let's just give them one last round of applause. Thank you guys both for coming.